We have a awesome guest speaker who happens to work here, Colten Lindberg, and he's going to be speaking on the resurrection, just in celebration of the resurrection, and he's going to be speaking on a really awesome passage. So I think we're going to have a really blessed time, and so let's just pray and bring this before the Lord, and just bless our time together. In Christ, we come to you, Lord, in your Son. We thank you for the gift of faith, for the gift of life, and just your presence in our hearts. We pray that you would bless us now through the worship, that we would set our hearts and minds on you and not waste this time together, Lord, that we would be strengthened, be encouraged, and equipped to just serve you better in our hearts, in our lives, and just love you and love those around us. Be with us, bless the message to our hearts. In Christ's name, amen.
Some of you may know, and some of you may not know, that the resurrection is not new to the New Testament. Obviously, Jesus did it in a very surprising and new kind of way, but there are Old Testament passages of the resurrection, and I just wanted to pick one from Ezekiel 37 today, just to read and to start our time. And as we do this, I want you to really seek to imagine what you're listening to. Imagine that this was you, and as the Lord brings us out to a valley of dry bones, imagine seeing these bones. You get the picture, but just imagine this with me as I read. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley, and it was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I said, Sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said, Prophesy to these bones and say to them, Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. And then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise rattling around. And then bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. So then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, This is what the Sovereign Lord says. Come, breath, from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them, so that they came to life and stood up on their feet. A vast army. And then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, This is what the Sovereign Lord says. My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you, and you will live. Lord, as we enter this time of worship and as we ponder upon your resurrection, Lord, help us to understand, help us to shake the familiarity of this story. Help us to shake the familiarity of the gospel. Help us to realize that this is so new and so mind-blowing to think of how you did this. Not just that you loved us that much, but God, you did it in such a crazy way. Lord, help us to peer into the mystery who is called Christ, and help us to see how you have given your life for the world. Lord, help us to worship with joy, because the joy of the Lord is our strength. Lord, let us look and be filled with hope, because, Lord, you are bringing new life all around. We love you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Storm surrounding me, let it break at your name. Still call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every wave at your name. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Bones to live, call these lungs to sing once again. I will praise Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Jesus, Jesus, you darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble.
Surrounding me, let it break at your name.
The head that was crowned with thorns, is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet, now at his feet we
options for the world to see. Your name is victory. sweet Jesus Christ, my sanity. Sweet Jesus Christ, my clarity. Bread of heaven, broken for me. Cup of salvation, held out to drink. Jesus, mystery. Christ has died and Christ is risen.
Thank you.
Sweet Jesus Christ, my sanity. Sweet Jesus Christ, my clarity.
Lord, we praise you because you are so good and you love us, Lord. Lord, you have redeemed us. And Lord, thank you for doing what you always do. And as we will learn today, Lord, you give us sight. Lord Jesus has changed the game forever. Help us to know and to peer into the mystery together today through the guidance of your Spirit and the opening of your word. Help us to see and to know and to see Jesus for who he is and not who we may mistake him to be. Lord, help us to not be shrouded by the things, by our ambitions, and thinking that they're your ambitions. Lord, let us humble ourselves to see you for who you really are. And so, Lord, as we continue praising you, listening to your word, responding to your word, listening, engaging in prayer, worshiping in our hearts, Lord, give us hearts that burn for you. We love you, Jesus, in your name. Amen. So today, we're going to be in Luke 24, and this is one of my favorite passages, and mostly because it caused me a lot of trouble when I read it the first time. I got to this passage, and it was kind of cryptic, and it's mysterious, and I think Luke did that for a reason. And Luke 24 is the last chapter in Luke's gospel. It's right before he transitions into the book of Acts. And so the way that Luke 24 ends is Luke is not just trying to tell you the historical details of what just happened, but he's trying to tell you what it means at the same time. And he's trying to not only, because imagine, Luke is not just writing an event as if it's a documentary or a security camera, but he is several years after the fact writing this, you know, into a scroll so that other people could read it and then experience it. And so Luke 24 is so cool because the way that Luke scripts this little chunk that we'll be focusing on, which is the part of the two disciples leaving Jerusalem on the way to Emmaus, it's really interesting. He leaves out details. He leaves out details about why Emmaus is specific. He leaves out details about who this other... We know that one of the disciples who is leaving Jerusalem is named Cleopas, but we don't know who this other disciple is. And so because of that, I want us to take the opportunity to imagine ourselves today as this other disciple, this other unnamed disciple. And I want us to begin to imagine what would we be thinking and feeling as we left Jerusalem after the events of Christ, after the moment when he was killed, executed brutally by the chief priests and the authorities and the governors of Rome who were positioned in Jerusalem. I want us to begin to imagine, what would that do to us? Like, we followed a guy, these two disciples, likely they were close with the 12, but they weren't of the 12, but they were in these groups of followers that were, who just, some people provided for Jesus, some people just followed Jesus to seek and to know him as king, some people just followed him to check them out, but these are two disciples who seem to be close with Jesus and close with the 12. And so these people had a lot at stake. They often, there's a good chance that they gave a lot up in order to follow this guy during his earthly practical ministry. And so as these two journey away from Jerusalem toward Emmaus, they're hopeless and they're distraught and they have no idea how to put together what just happened in Jerusalem. Okay, so right now we're going to take a moment. We're going to watch a 5-minute Bible Project video to kind of recap this scene of what the story of Luke, and specifically it's going to hone in and focus on the story of the two disciples heading to Emmaus, and specifically pay attention to what image this video presents Jesus' mission and role as Messiah to be. So as we watch this video, keep your eyes open, expect to see things you maybe haven't seen, because we need to come in this with a fresh set of eyes. And so, before we read the passage, let's go ahead and watch this. I'm going to sit down. So.
We've been looking at the story of Jesus as it's told in Luke's gospel. It begins with the arrival of an unlikely king born in poor, humble circumstances.
Then we saw Jesus as a teacher and prophet. He went throughout Israel calling people to a radical way of life, where enemies become friends, the poor are cared for, where people find forgiveness for their failures.
He went from town to town inviting people to follow him and live under God's reign in this upside-down way.
And he did many signs and wonders, so many Israelites began to hope that he would rescue Israel from the Romans and set up a new kingdom of peace and justice. In short, that he would bring the kingdom of God.
Now, the religious leaders of the day were also hoping for God's kingdom, but to them, the message of Jesus was a threat.
Yeah, they had expected to gain power and prestige when this all went down. But Jesus said God's kingdom belongs to the poor, to the outsider, and that real power is serving others in love.
This conflict intensified when Jesus, while in Jerusalem, disrupted the temple sacrifices and called Israel's leaders a gang of rebels.
So they arrested Jesus, and they had him accused before the Roman authorities of being a rebel king. He was handed over for execution, even though he was innocent. Then he was taken outside the city and put to death on false charges.
This brings us to the final section of the Gospel of Luke. There was a religious leader named Joseph who opposed Jesus' execution and then requested to be given his body so he could bury Jesus in a nearby tomb.
And then a couple of days later, some women who had followed Jesus came to visit that tomb, and they found it open and empty, and they encountered these mysterious figures telling them Jesus was alive from the dead. So they run away terrified. Nobody believes their report. I mean, he can't be alive. They all saw him die.
Now, just outside of Jerusalem, a pair of Jesus' followers were leaving the city, traveling on a road to a town called Emmaus, and they were sad and confused about everything that had happened.
Then Jesus shows up, walking alongside them, but they don't know it's him.
Yeah, that's weird. Why couldn't they recognize him?
Yeah, it's an odd but really significant image for Luke. They're blind to Jesus for some reason, so Jesus asks them, "What are you guys talking about?"
And they begin to tell him about Jesus, a powerful prophet who they expected would rescue Israel, but was instead executed. Some women say he's alive, which is crazy. It's all too much. We're going home.
So Jesus tries to explain that this is what the Jewish scriptures had been pointing to all along, that Israel needed a king who would suffer and die as a rebel on behalf of those who actually are rebels. And then he would be vindicated by his resurrection so he could give true life to those who would receive it.
But it's still not making sense. They're as confused as ever.
Which leads to the scene where they sit down for a meal with Jesus. He takes the bread, he blesses it, breaks it, and gives it to them, just as he did at the Last Supper.
Yeah, this is the image of his broken body, his death on the cross.
And it's when they take in the broken bread, that's when their eyes are open to see Jesus. Then he disappears, and the episode's over.
So this is a story about how it's hard to see Jesus for who he really is.
Yes, this is brilliant. I mean, how could God's royal power and love be revealed through this man's shameful execution? How could a humble man become the king of the world through weakness and self-sacrifice? It's very hard to see. But this is the message of the Gospel of Luke. It takes a transformation of your imagination to see it and embrace Jesus's upside-down kingdom.
The Gospel of Luke ends with Jesus and all of his disciples together over another meal, and everyone's freaking out about his resurrected body. I mean, he's still a human, but way more.
Yes, he's passed through death and come out the other side, a walking, talking piece of new creation. And then Jesus tells them that he's going to give them the same divine power that sustained him, so they can go out and share the good news of God's kingdom with other people.
After this, Luke tells us that Jesus was taken up into heaven, which is a cool exit and all, but why disappear into the sky?
So in the Old Testament, the skies are the place of God's throne. They're above everything. So this is Luke's way of showing that Jesus has been enthroned as the divine king of the whole world.
His followers stay in Jerusalem, worshiping God and Jesus, waiting for this new power, and this is where the gospel ends.
Now, Luke is going to write about how they receive this power and take the news out into the world, and that's what his second volume, the Book of Acts, is all about.
Let's pray and ask the Lord to give us sight so we can see the real Jesus. Lord, we just want to, as disciples, as followers of you, we want to humble ourselves so that we can really, truly see you, to not be like those who can walk beside you and miss you, but Lord, in your grace, Please show yourself to us. Help us to understand not just who you are and what you seek to do in the world, not just what your kingdom's about, but God, help us to see like what that means for us today. And help us to see how the resurrection, how Easter in just a few days is just this pivotal moment for all of history. And since then, life has been forever different. Help us to see and to truly perceive. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Let's go ahead and read. So we're just going to focus right in on this story of the road to Emmaus. So now that same day, two of them who were going to a village called Emmaus about 7 miles, were going to a village called Emmaus about 7 miles from Jerusalem. So this is two of some of the, like a larger group of disciples. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But the eyes of their hearts were kept from seeing them. The NIV kind of loses that, but that's why "of your hearts" is there in that. But the eyes of their hearts were kept from perceiving him. He asked them, so this is Jesus, to his disciples, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stopped, faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" Jesus asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed, before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is now the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they did not find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus." So this is kind of the scene in the story. Actually, this may have cut off right when the video busted, but this is them. They are having this conversation with Jesus, and they're truly disappointed. Like, their dreams are shattered. Remember, you just left Jerusalem because you're one of these disciples, and you just left Jerusalem and your Messiah just died. Not just that, but all that momentum for 3 years, everything that he did and taught, the whole new way of life about like turning the other cheek and loving your neighbor as you love yourself, like these crazy ways that they felt were crazy to themselves, but yet had learned to live and learned to see that this was good through watching Jesus being this prophet of God who was powerful in word and deed. And yet they just watched him just get destroyed. They watched him just get destroyed. And so this is their functioning belief. A dead Messiah is a failed Messiah. And that makes total sense for them and for the day. We need to give them compassion for that, because I mean, I don't know any other person who is resurrected from the dead besides Jesus, and neither did they. And even the old Hebrew understanding of resurrection was different. Like, they talked about all the time how someone would be risen up in the spirit of Elijah, and they would be someone who would be carrying a certain kind of message. And that, a lot of times for them, like they didn't have a clear picture of what the resurrection was. They didn't know how to clearly envision it, but like they had some elusive texts that seemed to kind of fit together what a resurrection could look like, and we saw one of those in Ezekiel today, you know, where they can imagine this thing happening, but for them, this was still a far off, distant vision. And yet, so we have two disciples who are completely distraught. We find out that Jesus is not in the tomb. Someone had obviously stolen his body. They don't know then these women are saying crazy things. They have no idea what to believe. And what's so cool about this story is that if you find yourself right now saying, "I have no idea what's going on," or "I have no idea what to believe," this is the story for you. Because as these two were walking along, sharing their hopes and dreams, and ultimately how they believed them to be crushed, Jesus just walks up beside them. They didn't know it was Jesus, they saw that it was another human, but they didn't perceive who he actually was. And so would you flip over? In this moment, after Cleopas gets done explaining that he had hoped that Jesus would be the one to redeem Israel, Jesus said to them, and It's not said there, but Jesus is speaking to their perception. A lot of the text in Luke is about sight and seeing and recognizing. So he said to them, how foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. And he's speaking to their perception, like, do you guys not see me? He's not slapping them on the wrists, but he's like, do you guys not see what's going on? How slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And so this moment, Jesus is trying to correct their understanding of what the kingdom was and what the Messiah came to do. And I think in their minds, up until this point, they had been looking to military leaders who were going to come in, you know, smack the pagans around, chop heads, free Israel of Rome, of the Roman tyranny that they found themselves in, free themselves so that they could be... They were imagining this, the Exodus would happen again. They were imagining that Pharaoh would be destroyed and that they would be liberated with an outstretched arm. Like, this is what they were expecting a Messiah would do and be. And then their Messiah died. Like, everything they had understood the Messiah to do was now like, So Jesus had this awesome Bible study with them, teaching them about Moses and the prophets and explaining to them about how the scriptures point to him, and they still not get it. They don't still get it. So please flip, as they approached the village to which they were going, which was Emmaus, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, saying, stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over. And so this is kind of the scene, at least in the picture of the Bible Project. Go ahead. And so when he was at the table with them, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and began to give it to them. And it was at that moment. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And then after that, he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, were our hearts not burning within us while he talked with us and opened the scriptures to us? Keep going. And this is that point I think we kind of missed with the break of the video. Like, they illustrated this moment so well, where like they were listening to the story of the Passover, and they watched Jesus take this bread and break it exactly like he did when he had that last meal with them. And as they broke it, the video showed this scene where like they can see the bread and a blurry Jesus, and then flash forward, they see this. They see this broken bread and this very clear Jesus. And I think this is the story that Luke wants us to see, is that the only way to really, truly, not just see Jesus as a human, but to perceive Jesus and who he was going to do, we must understand him in the context of the story that he came to do, in the mission that he came to do. And he came to die, to give his life a ransom for many. It's crazy because aside from that text there, Jesus came and gave his life as a ransom for many, there aren't many texts at all that express the meaning of his death. But instead of giving his disciples a lecture about the meaning of his death, Jesus did something very strange. He gave them a meal. And he gave them a meal to internalize, to experience, to understand, also in a way that's different than the way that we receive rational information. But he gave them something to break and to experience and to remember. And as many of us know, we practice a meal very similar to this when we go and worship Jesus together in our local bodies and our local churches. And this is an opportunity, since the moment that Jesus has been resurrected, parties, groups, disciples of Jesus have been breaking bread and finding Jesus in the scriptures ever since. And so what's so beautiful is that this passage in Luke gives us this scene of what exactly happened after his resurrection, but also portrays this reality that we as disciples, to understand what just happened, we must understand it in the lens, through the lens of what he did, like what he gave his life for, but also trusting it within the reality that he is capable of raising from the dead, and that God the Father vindicated Jesus in his life and his work and what he did, and said, this is the right way. And so as the disciples once came to see the cross as being a failure, a dead Messiah is a failed Messiah, they now have this different voice inside their heads. They now are beginning to understand and see that my execution was not a failure. My execution was my exaltation. This was exactly the thing that was supposed to happen. And I know that we're 2 minutes over, so I'm going to wrap this up real quick. And the goal here is to say that if you find yourself in situations that look like the cross, where you have no sense of navigation, and when you have nothing around you that may, you, how do you live on after this? These things have happened. Like if you read what we pray through as a prayer team at Light EMV, if you find yourself in one of those situations, or if many of those prayers represent you guys in this room, like we know how it looks like to be living in a life where things just don't make sense. We understand how hard it is to honor and to listen to Jesus and to obey the kingdom commands and to live this new life. Because honestly, if in this world, if we turn the other cheek, we're going to get hit again. In this world, if we, like, the ways that we take care of people actually open us to be exploited. The way that Jesus has taught us to love and the way that the resurrection of Jesus vindicates as the right way is this way that gets us stomped on in this life. And Jesus wants us to know that whatever happens on this side of things, that it does not touch what the Father can actually do. And no matter who we understand or how we understand a certain moment to be, this story gives us an opportunity to peer through the mystery of Christ in the scriptures and the breaking of bread and to see that there is resurrection, not just for Jesus, but for us also. As we read in Ezekiel 37 this morning, like that was a scene where the Son of Man was prophesying and watching bones collect and connect tendons on flesh. And next thing you know, he sees a sea of people. And what we come to learn is like Jesus is doing that for us. He's doing that for us, and the Son of Man came to give his life as a ransom for many. And so when we understand the upside down, the backwards nature of Jesus' kingdom, it challenges the way that we see the world. It challenges the way that we see relationships. It challenges the ways that we come into situations with these unchecked assumptions and these preconceptions. But this also gives us a really cool encouragement that we can lay aside and to humble ourselves and in doing so, trust that Jesus will show himself to be there, to be faithful, and to be the one who redeems all things. Cleopas said, and we were hoping that he would be the one, that Jesus would be the one to redeem Israel. And Jesus redeemed Israel. The thing is, it wasn't through breaking skulls, but it was through giving his own life. And that is the model for which we are to live the life, our lives now and forever. And so I just want to pray because I know we're about 5 minutes over, and let's just go ahead and pray. Lord, we love you. And we, if we're honest, we find ourselves as those disciples who journey from Jerusalem to Emmaus often. We don't always know, and frequently we don't know, if we're honest, like what's going on around us. But yet we still live by and make decisions by the seat of our pants, making them whatever seems right to our own eyes. Lord, help us to lay aside these things. Help us to understand not just what happens in the scriptures, not just what you're doing, but what we see in the world through a lens of resurrection. Lord, help us to understand that you are making all things new, starting with Jesus. Help us to understand that new creation is bursting forth now. The Spirit is on this planet, and he is making us into the temples of God. And wherever the Spirit is, Lord, you reign with us. You reign there. And Lord, we thank you for all that you do. God, help us to walk away from this encouraged and also challenged. Challenge that we may not see the world rightly and that we may need to come to you for guidance. But Lord, help us to feel encouraged because you have resurrected from the dead and you have promised that same thing for each of us. And Lord, as we continue to trust in you, Lord, give us your Spirit so that we can really truly know this life of freedom, this life of joy, and this life of the kingdom that you have now made available to us through Jesus. The cross wasn't a failure. It was your victory, Lord, and we praise you and we thank you for winning. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys. Really appreciate it.